Hey y'all, hey Clara. Hey Andrew. Just give it a couple more seconds to get some people on. Hey Daddy. Hey Chris. Hey Catherine. Hope y'all are having a good day. I'll get started here in just a second. Hey Laura and Lori, Sherry. Hey Mary from Hilton Head. Hey Aunt Vangie. All right, so we got enough people. We'll go ahead and get started, y'all. I hope y'all are having a great day. It's absolutely beautiful down here right now. It's a privilege to be back downtown, especially since my last video, it was pouring rain that day. Today, and Andrew mentioned it a little bit yesterday, this whole week we're doing nothing but talking about Charleston's disasters, both natural and man-made disasters. And I must have drawn the short stick because I got the Civil War and Reconstruction, which is probably one of the most heavily researched, also probably one of the most heavily debated topics in American history. But to start talking about this topic, I'm actually going to do things a little bit different. I'm actually going to take us on a walking tour today, talk about different sites, and I'm going to try to weave the story together. I could easily give a two-hour lecture on this, but I'll try to keep it short, sweet, and to the point. And for the first stop, I'm actually going to show y'all my favorite plant. It grows in abundance here in Charleston and all over the Southeast, all over the Deep South. And that is Confederate jasmine. And so let me turn this around so y'all can see it. So this small little plant right here, that is Confederate jasmine. And I said it's my favorite plant. It's my favorite plant because of the aroma that it throws off. It's sort of almost like a mixture of honeysuckle and magnolia, and it is absolutely flourishing right now. The city is just covered with a thick blanket of Confederate jasmine perfume. But I'll tell y'all, let me turn this back around. Tell y'all, one of my tours probably took place a few years ago. We were walking down Meeting Street, and I'll do a pan so y'all can see my view right now. We were walking down Meeting Street and had a lady on my tour that asked, "What is that wonderful smell?" And I said, that's the Confederate jasmine. Again, you can see more of it growing right here. And she said, "I love the smell, but I'm not too fond of the name." And I'm all about history lessons. And I said, "All right, well, let's take a seat and let's talk about that." So talking about the Civil War and Reconstruction today, oftentimes in the South, it's pretty common for you to hear the Civil War referred to as either the Confederate War or the war between the states. And that's because history is all about perspectives. History is more than just a collection of dates and facts. It's a story. And a story can oftentimes change based on the person who's telling it. And so when you look at the definition of a civil war, it's a conflict occurring between citizens of the same nation. Well, from a Southern or a Confederate standpoint, it really wasn't so much a civil war as it was a war for independence, a war of sovereignty to separate the South from the United States government. I remember when I was in college, I was part of a traveling ministry team. We were a vocal ensemble. We were taking a tour of the Pentagon up near D.C. And we were walking through the Civil War galleries. And our tour guide kept saying that the Army was defending Washington from the enemy. Well, for the whole rest of the tour, I kept trying to figure out, why would the Confederates be defending Washington? Which is when it clicked for the first time in my life. I'm here in the Civil War from a more Northern versus Southern perspective. So I thought that was really cool. It was very interesting. Of course, in Charleston, everybody jokes that there wasn't a thing civil about the Civil War. especially as far as this city was concerned. Charleston endured 587 days of federal bombardment, the longest siege of any U.S. city in American history, and the second longest siege of any city in world history, second only to the Battle of Leningrad, which took place during World War II. At its height, federal troops were shelling about a dozen rounds into the city center, you know, at the height of that bombardment, and it did untold amounts of damage. And so the first house that I'm going to show y'all, and I'll walk over here to it, is what's known in Charleston as the Confederate Headquarters House. Hold on. Almost there. I'll go ahead and pan around so y'all can see more of the view. Y'all can see the single houses right over there. And so the house that I'm walking up on right now, called the Confederate Headquarters House, also known as the James Simmons House, is where General Beauregard had his headquarters during the early years of the Civil War. But of course, when that bombardment broke out, General Beauregard had to move his headquarters here from the Simmons House, a mile up the road to Governor Aiken's mansion. And General Beauregard ordered the evacuation of everything south of Calhoun Street. So a good chunk of the city was completely abandoned during the second half of the Civil War. But it wasn't totally abandoned. Okay, see, someone says, voice going in and out. Turn this back around. Does that help at all? I'll try to get closer to it so everybody can hear me. So the city wasn't totally abandoned during the Civil War. Now, all those wealthy rice planters, all those well-to-do Sea Island cotton planters, they, you know, left the environs of town. Some of them went to the highlands of North Carolina. Some went to the Pendleton area in South Carolina. Others went up to the Darlington, Hartsville, Society Hill area, in any place that they could get away from the bombardment. That left nothing but members of, you know, the poorer classes, the middling sort behind. And those poor souls definitely got the full extent of federal guns. There's a pretty tragic story that involves a brother and a sister. They were attending a church service at the Catholic Church. They were having, you know, confessional, taking communion or such. And they were leaving the church, and a Union mortar shell, you know, was launching through the sky. It exploded, and the shrapnel killed the pair of them right there on the steps of the church. So the federal bombardment lasted 587 days, didn't even stop on Christmas or on Easter. And so once, you know, I'm done here, I invite y'all to Google Charleston, South Carolina, 1865, and you'll be pretty amazed at the extent of damage wrought on by federal guns. And so the question that I get on my tours, well, after all of that extensive bombardment, how in the world did all of these houses survive? And I'll pan around so y'all can see a little bit more of them. So how did all of these structures survive? There are more than 2,000 private residences that are considered historic structures in the city. And really, to answer the question of how they survived, you have to examine the state of the economy at the end of the Civil War. That plantation economy completely crashed. For example, William Bull Pringle, who lived over on King Street, he was worth $500,000 in 1860 currency. That's about $15 million in today's money. At the end of the war, he was valued at a grand total of $87.54. So he went from being half a millionaire to only, you know, nothing but $87.54. And it was the same for a lot of the other Joes in town, especially those well-to-do rice planting and Sea Island cotton planting families. Now, there were a few exceptions to the rule. Prosperity, you know, did latch on to a few people. For example, here we have the Calhoun Mansion. This is the largest private residence in the city, 24,000 square feet of living space, and it was completed in 1876. It was the home of George Walton Williams, who was a blockade runner. So he'd made his money going against the federal blockade. So he did pretty well. He was rumored to be worth $1 million in gold by 1870. So you gather he wasn't hurting too much for money. But back to, you know, the planter class. They were the ones that definitely felt the brunt of the war, especially financially speaking. You have Williams Middleton. Williams Middleton was the owner of Middleton Place Plantation, one of the historic sites that you can visit along the Ashley River. Yeah, someone said North and South TV show. Yep, that's where, that was one of the filming locations back there at the Calhoun Mansion. But anyway, so Williams Middleton, owner of Middleton Place. He came from a very long line of political figures. His great-grandfather was one of the presidents of the Continental Congress. His grandfather, Arthur Middleton, signed the Declaration of Independence. His father, Henry Middleton, was the first U.S. ambassador to Russia. So I always say that Williams Middleton had to, you know, some steep competition that he was going up when it came to his family. So Williams Middleton was one of the signers of the South Carolina Ordinance of Secession. And he felt so passionately about states' rights and defending the institution of slavery that he underlined his name three times. So he pulled a John Hancock move. He wanted to make sure that everyone knew that Williams Middleton had signed the document. But because he had signed the Ordinance of Secession, that put a target on his back and on the rest of his property as well. In late February 1865, after the fall of Charleston, federal troops acting under orders of General Sherman were sailing up the Ashley River, and they were burning pretty much everything in sight. That included the main house at Middleton Place. Again, Williams Middleton had been one of the signers of the Ordinance of Secession. A plantation owner hit pretty hard after the war. So much so that here at his townhouse, I'll pan around so y'all can see that, number one Meeting Street, Williams Middleton's townhouse, he actually opened the house up to lodgers. He opened up a boarding house, essentially, in that house. You know, a far cry from the days when he had been on top of everything. So you have not only total economic devastation, but you also have political upheaval as well. After the war, during the Union occupation of Charleston, and by the way, Charleston was under federal occupation until federal troops were finally withdrawn in 1883. That's 18 years after the end of the Civil War. So during the Union occupation of Charleston, if you had been a Confederate officer, if you had served in any capacity in the Confederate government, or if you owned property that was valued at $2,500 in 1860 currency, you were not allowed to vote, you were not allowed to own guns, and you were not allowed to get your property back until you swore an oath of allegiance to the federal government. Some did, some didn't. One of my favorite stories involves Rudolph Siegling. He had been a Confederate officer. He refused to swear the oath of allegiance to the federal government, but he didn't want all of his guns to fall into their hands. So what was a little clever, he took all of his rifles, all of his pistols, to the family's business over on King Street. It was the Siegling Music House. And basically took the guns, hid them in the walls so that federal troops couldn't find them. And he must have forgotten about it too, because the family didn't discover the rifles again until the 1970s after they had sold the business off. I always thought that was an interesting story that he was willing to go to those lengths. Gentlemen, Charles Alston, he lived over at 21 East Battery. He did choose to swear the oath of allegiance to the United States. But even after he got the presidential pardon, he wasn't able to get his townhouse back for 3 years. And the reason for that is because the head of the Freedmen's Bureau had commandeered the house as a headquarters and wasn't too ready to give it up. He had taken a liking to that grand mansion on East Battery. So I've talked a good deal, you know, what life was like for especially the elites in Charleston, the plantation class. But what about the other half? What we say the half has never been told. Bear in mind that before the Civil War, more than half of Charleston's population and South Carolina as a whole state were enslaved people. So what happens? What do you do when you've been given your freedom? You're no longer considered property. Well, they had a few options. Some of those individuals chose to go up north in the hopes of starting life anew. Others chose to leave the plantations and just come directly into Charleston. I'm hoping to find jobs and you know, start businesses of their own. Some chose to go out west. They would become homesteaders. Others simply chose to stay on the plantations for a variety of different reasons. One, this is, you know, imagine this is the first time in generations that a member of your family has been given any sort of freedom whatsoever. All you know is how to cultivate rice. So many of those individuals stayed on the old plantations and worked as sharecroppers for their former owners. There's a really interesting interview involving Annette Mays. Annette Mays was born into slavery at Middleton Place. Again, that was owned by Williams Middleton. And in an interview that was done later in her life, she was asked, what did she think about emancipation at the time? And now that she's, you know, much older, what are her reflections on her past? What's the reflections on our history? And it's a very interesting interview. She said that all in all, she couldn't stand the Yankees because she was considered high class before the war, which definitely, you know, throws in the fact that there was a unique caste system that developed in the antebellum South. And being the cook, one of the most expensive slaves that a slaveholder could own, being a cook gave her a status, a position above other people. And of course, with emancipation, she lost it. So it kind of made her mad. I always thought that was an interesting story. Another one, though, which really hits home for a lot of people, is an interview that was done of Sue Alston. Sue Alston was the housekeeper up at Hampton Plantation, which is now a state park. I believe Andrew's going to be doing a video from there once the parks open back up. But she was interviewed in the 1930s. And the quote that she gave still stirs my heart up a little bit. She said that after the Civil War, the Yankee broke the chains of slavery, but he never took the rope. They broke the chains, but never took. Sorry, y'all. Broke the chains, but never took the rope. Which almost makes you want to tear up just a little bit because it drives home the fact that once the Civil War was over, and even once Reconstruction was completed, it wasn't like everybody sat down at the table of brotherhood together. The end of the Civil War would start more than 100 years of oppression for a good chunk of the population of the entire South, not just in Charleston, but in other Southern states and in other places in the country as well. And so it wasn't necessarily an easy fix. And I know, you know, that this whole week's supposed to be about the disasters and the trials and the tribulations that Charleston has faced. But when it comes to the Civil War, when it comes to Reconstruction, it's not, you can't set an end date in stone. And some people would say that we're still in the process of Reconstruction. And so I'd sort of like to end here at my favorite place in the city. This is White Point Gardens, my favorite place to go in town. And the history of the land that we're standing on is pretty incredible. You have one, the story that the pirate bodies are buried somewhere here on this ground. you have the first public park in Charleston. This is where ladies would take the early morning promenade. During the Civil War, this is called the Battery. It's where Confederate guns were positioned in defense of the city. But White Point Gardens was also one of the first places in the city to be integrated during the Civil Rights Movement. And to sort of bring this topic to a close, I'd like to talk about another Charleston lady. Her name was Septima Poinsett Clark. She was the grandchild of slaves. She had been an educator. She taught school to the underprivileged on the Sea Islands. She was a civil rights activist. And during one of the interviews that someone conducted with her, she was asked the question, have you ever thought about leaving Charleston? You know, I assume that they were implying maybe, you know, go to a place where the struggle for equality is easier. And her response was this, I have never left Charleston, nor shall I. Charleston is my home. I love the city of Charleston. I love her people, black and white. And I have no doubts that my final days will be spent here between the Ashley and the Cooper Rivers, where Charlestonians never doubt the Atlantic Ocean begins. And so I think that's a testament to her strength of character. And to be honest with y'all, combing through all of the primary sources, all the places that I went to get all the quotes and the statistics, one theme definitely reigns supreme in every story, every scenario, every diary entry. How did these people survive? How did these people overcome? My interpretation and my answer for it would be hope driven by faith. Hope driven by faith is how I think they were able to overcome their trials and their tribulations, which is something I think not only reigns true throughout history, but it's something that we can definitely use and definitely learn from today, especially with what's going on in the world right now. Andrew had mentioned this, and a person had commented yesterday on the video that, you know, history is full of scars. And I think that that's definitely true. But when we choose to examine those scars, they can serve as a roadmap for us in the future. So I hope y'all have enjoyed listening in on me today. I know it went a little long, but hopefully y'all enjoyed it. If y'all have any questions, let me sort of just go through, see if we got anything. Let's see. Oh, difficulties. I always tell people if something's not 150 years old, it doesn't interest me. That includes technology. I always struggle with it. But what I'll do, I'll scroll back through the comments. If anyone has any questions, I'll be happy to reply to those. But I hope y'all have a wonderful day. I'm going to do just one more pan so that y'all can see the harbor and the two rivers. Here you go, South Battery, White Point. You can see the harbor beyond there. And the oleanders in full bloom as well. So thank y'all so much for joining me today. I hope y'all have a blessed afternoon and tune in tomorrow. Y'all take care.